Good morning, everyone, and welcome. I'm Marie-Louise T. Sørensen. We haven't worked in this room before. It is wonderful, but very long. So please, if you sit at the back, nonetheless, psychological feel as if you sit at the front. So participate and be involved and do everything that is necessary to make an event an event. So I'm very, very happy to welcome you on behalf of the organizing committee. And I want to tell you that I picked this very colorful dress, or at least in England it's a colorful dress, in order to sort of set the right tone. I hope the meeting will be lively, but not formal, that we will be engaged, not passive, that we will be critical, questioning without aggression, that the aim should be that each of us over the next 2 days will think something or even say something that we could not have predicted, that our insight will become more nuanced, our sense of engagement excited, and our ideas for future actions more focused and explicit. We are all here to learn, I hope, even to learn about our own thoughts and positions as they become reflected through those of others with similar concerns and passions. Can you hear me at the back? The challenge of heritage in Africa, is that not a too overwhelming topic to discuss over 2 days? Is it not an artificial limitation, taking Africa as if it was a coherent context, echoing a colonial gaze and negating the enormous variation involved? With what kind of legitimacy do we discuss Africa's heritage, especially if we have no practical involvement or no responsibility for what happens or could happen? These are all concerns we debated when making the call for this conference. And they are very legitimate concerns and strictures. But there were also very strong and important arguments for the endeavors which allowed us to nonetheless move forward, especially if our aim is to engender discussions and create networks rather than thinking that we will offer immediate solutions. This view was clearly supported by the overwhelming amount of proposals which we got when we opened the call. We could only select a limited number of these proposals, and it was a very difficult selection to make. But the wide and wide-ranging interest was very obvious. And I strongly believe that this conference will need, whatever we manage to do, it will need to be followed by others, potentially by meeting dedicated to specific challenges that hopefully might emerge more clearly as we discuss. So what are the reasons for making this what are the reasons that make this conference relevant and legitimate? We have used some of the core topics that constitute both challenges and also some of the particular characteristics of Africa's heritage to structure the program. And all your contributions, as also those who are going to contribute by just participating in discussions, will in some way help to constellate those particular topics. We selected, however, to focus on the potential roles or challenges of heritage in terms of future development. This means paying attention to the connection between heritage, development, and sustainability. A constellation of concepts with very obvious tensions, maybe even contradictions between them. What are the costs of development for heritage? But also, what are the costs if heritage does not participate in development? To be of social significance, heritage needs to be in the present and be part of plans for the future. But it's not clear whether that will always entail an exploitation, transformation, adaptation of heritage to make it fit into those plans. And therefore, whether indeed change is an essential aspect of heritage if it has to be alive. In addition, at a deeper level, we also need to be concerned about whether with African concepts of heritage. And more specifically, we need to consider whether there are some characteristics of African heritage that make it somewhat different from what we experience on other continents. and which therefore means that unique contribution both about the nature of heritage and about the politics and practice of heritage management may arise by that attention to what's going on in heritage in Africa. And I wanted to just try to point to three aspects, and they're very preliminary thoughts. I haven't thought this through, and I'm not the right person to think it through. Many of you here with much greater expertise. The first point is about the nature of the relationship to heritage. I've been wondering whether we, within some African heritage discourse and practices, encounter a different kind of relationship with heritage than we see, for example, in Europe. I see this difference encapsulated in the differences in the terms, in the language use, in particular the difference between the term of guardian versus customary right. And I think we see that reflected in very genuine important, in the very general importance of oral tradition in many areas of Africa and the role of elders and chiefs in many regions. Let me explain it a little bit better. We use guardians to refer to a person or an institution who has the legal right and responsibility of taking care of something or someone. It's about protecting something. This is therefore a terminology that refers entirely to the role, but it indicates nothing about where that responsibility comes from, how it may have been earned or acquired. This is a term commonly used in international heritage management speech, and also the one we use in Europe. In contrast, in many parts of Africa, protection is quickly linked to arguments about customary rights or traditional rights, which, although it often involves protection and caretaking, primarily makes the basis of responsibility and rights clear. They are acquired by custom. They are therefore distinct and argue for a particularistic relationship with the past rather than in some way governmental. This distinction has, I think, not only legal repercussion, but also affects a range of emotional and moral notions of rights and responsibility and how ideas of entitlement may be formulated. Thus, we talk about and regulate. Thus, this is about how we talk about and regulate our relationship to heritage, and that we might do in different ways in different parts of the world. This is important since we at another level speak about heritage as if it is a similar kind of phenomena everywhere. Wherever we encounter it, it is a similar kind of authorized heritage discourse. While heritage management and heritage meaning in Europe can be understood as a very hierarchical relationship, certainly in terms of its government and management, but I also think to some extent in terms of meaning, I wonder whether in parts of Africa we may be thinking not just of an entanglement, and I noticed that that word is coming in some of the African literature, but maybe even about a kind of parallelism between local practice and government. So, and I know lots of you have worked with this kind of thing, but I think it's worth also trying to comprehend and think about what is actually the nature of the difference. So that was my first point. My second point is about history. So if indeed there are such distinct relationship to heritage, it is equally clear that that does not find expression in all parts of Africa. So why is that the case? And this is, so this takes me to my second point. I worked myself in Cabo Verde off the coast of West Africa together with Christopher Evans, and Marcus have been there as well. There we find no or very little oral history attached to the heritage. The Cabo Verde Islands were uninhabited until late 15th century, and the modern country is entirely a result of the slave trade. And social history and memory is shallow. There is no connection to place of origins or no history of people and connecting them to the landscape around them. We know from other parts of the world that deep ruptures in people's connection with place will affect their sense of heritage, what the heritage can do for them, and the shape it takes. Africa has a history of rupture. Its population, their relationship to the environment, have been brutally impacted in a variety of ways. And I think we need to keep that historical baggage in mind when we try to comprehend the huge variety in how heritage is valued and what aspect is given significance within the continent. I think it may be useful not to take the heritage for granted, but to always appreciate its resulting from how people need to create meaning and the very different ways these have to be done, and the role the historical conditions have in providing those means. Thirdly, heritage in Africa is clearly enormously rich, varied, and alive. Critique of the World Heritage Convention has taught us that it can neither be comprehended nor responded to in terms of giving primacy to monumental heritage. That's not a new observation, that's a very familiar critique by now. But I think we should also be cautious about how well the concept of intangible heritage, as defined by UNESCO and other agencies, actually captures some of the fundamentals of heritage in Africa. I wonder whether, just like the phenomena such as the Aboriginal dream times in Australia, of an expectation to what characterizes intangible heritage for some reasons may still leave some of the essential characteristics beyond the reach of our categorization. Our understanding of intangible heritage focuses on craft and traditions of knowledge expressed like, for example, the living expressions inherited from ancestor and the skills of producing traditional craft, quote from UNESCO. Although this may appear abstract, the practice of such intangible skills or tradition needs to be related to form, and practice and performance very quickly become the focus of intangible heritage discourses. But if there are relationships in which heritage is a matter of being rather than performing and doing, then I think we find that the concept of intangible heritage does not satisfy, it doesn't go deep enough. I think that in Africa, we find customary practices in which heritage is a kind of embodiment. I'm in particular thinking about belief, in which current notion of the intangible goes together with knowledge and craft, not capturing, I think, the very different kind of heritage which are experienced and lived when we talk about belief. So I wonder whether heritage practice in Africa may challenge this way of categorizing heritage by revealing complex essentialistic differences within what we now label intangible heritage. For example, that belief and knowledge are existentially different levels of heritage and different levels of engagement. As part of this questioning, we may learn that other core categories, such as, for example, nature and culture, may also become destabilized and rethought if you place Africa heritage central in our contemplation rather than a kind of practice we'd have to adjust to thinking in other parts of the world. So my 3 points had little to do with the actual aim of this conference, apparently. However, at the level of theory as well as practical solution, in terms of the urgency that of the challenges we face today, the potential specificity of heritage in Africa and its many parts and many variations need to be brought into our thinking. I think to make heritage part of the future or part of the present, we actually need to comprehend what heritage is.